Velocity painting. Sounds cool, right? You've probably seen it used somewhere out there already, and basically you can like change the texture of your 3D prints without actually changing the geometry. I think this is super cool, and if you're a bit creative with the technique, you can do so many things with it that aren't even just for messing around. Well, mostly. It just looks super cool though. So in this video, I'm going to show you how velocity painting works, how you can set up the prints, and some tricks for how to get the most out of it. So in essence, velocity painting is a really simple concept. Did you ever notice the little pimples or under-extruded bits at the start or end of a line in your 3D prints? Well, those are there because while the motion system is very good at changing speed and direction quickly, your printer's hot end is not. It can't just go from extruding slowly to pumping out tons of material. It always has that bit of lag to it. Most slicers and printers try to work around that limitation with a ton of different tricks, but what we're doing with velocity painting is that we're intentionally using that lag to create patterns, images, texts burnt into a 3D print. You take your sliced, ready-to-print file, an image that you can overlay, and the velocity painting tool will turn that image into speed variations in your 3D print that you can actually see in the finished part without actually modeling anything into your 3D model. I've got two different use cases here, which I've already printed out, and there's a ton more ways to use velocity painting, which I'll show you towards the end of the video. But what I have is like the straightforward way to use it, you imprint a motif into your part. So what I did is that I simply created the cylinder model, just to demonstrate this, and then used an image to imprint into the part. Here's how you do that. First, slice your model as usual. I used vase mode for this, but it also works for regular infill or several walls. Just keep in mind that even the infill is going to get tattooed. Not that it would matter much, but if your parts need to be particularly strong, velocity painting might not be the right tool for you. All right, next up, you'll need the velocity painting software, which you can get from velocitypainting.xyz. And yes, that's the web address. If you're on Windows, you probably want the x64 version, but you can also get it for macOS or Debian-based Linux systems. The software itself is rather easy to use. You start at the top where you load in your raw G-code file and your image. You then move down into image details where you set how large the image projection is supposed to end up on your print. You can get the size of your 3D model from your slicer for reference. If you don't want your image to get stretched, use one of the online aspect ratio calculators and your original image size in pixels to figure out what, for example, your height needs to be based on your target width to keep proportions. Z offset, as the name implies, just shifts the image up or down on your print. One box further down, you set what the software calls printer coordinates, but basically you're just setting the spot you want your image to be centered around. So if you want to move the image on your print, just change these values. We're going to take a look at print speeds in a second, but first let's check out paint type, as this is the most impactful setting for changing the way velocity painting works. The default is projection X, and it basically wipes your image through the part along the x-axis, so from left to right, or right to left, same thing. Anywhere a bright part of the image grazes the part, it'll use a higher speed, and anywhere the image is dark, you know, it'll go slower. And that looks like this. So mapping the image with projection Y or projection Z is pretty much the same thing. It just wipes the image through your part in a different direction. But the cylindrical and spherical modes are a bit different. So let's start with the spherical one. I guess the best way you explain this is if you imagine your image as an explosion in the center of your part that goes outwards in all directions equally. So obviously you'd use it if you want to paint a world map onto a sphere or make one of those cool lithopane moon prints where you see the surface of the moon as soon as you shine a light through the part. The other option is cylindrical, and it's kind of similar, but instead of coming from a point and going to all directions, it spreads from a vertical line along the horizontal plane. I don't know if that makes sense, so here's another way to think about it. Your image just gets wrapped around the part. Easy. This is that typical use case that you use for vases. Vases, whatever. The one bit that we still need to cover is the speeds, and you can, well, you should use it to set up not just how fast your part prints, but also how strong the velocity painting effect ends up. The speeds you set here override anything you configured in your slicer before. going from 20 over 50 to 80 millimeters a second worked out pretty well for me, but it was on the more extreme side. For example, this part printed and transparent protopasta PLA ended up really under extruded in the bits where it started speeding up. And in fact, this isn't watertight anymore. I can even just blow right through this. Also, one thing you shouldn't forget here, the default is millimeters per minute. So if you just input the same ballpark of speeds as in your slicer, which are millimeters a second, you'll get something like this. So don't forget to change it to millimeters per second over here. Just saying, not that I would have ever forgotten to change it. But the best thing really is to just save the entire thing as a preset. Super easy. Next up, filaments. Not all of them work out equally well. This right here was the exact same cheat code on all three prints, but the results are totally different. So this first one is a prototype of Dust Filament Infinity Blue, and I was hoping that the difference in extrusion width that Velocity Painting creates would create a look that kind of changes the translucency in the print, but I think this is actually the one that turned out the worst. The effect is just way too subtle, I think. Next up, the Prusa Silver, which is the one that they're including with printers. And it's got a really strong metallic effect to it, which tends to bring our printer flaws a ton. But since we're basically creating imperfections on purpose with Velocity Painting, the metallic sheen really works in our favor here and makes for a good contrast. Lastly, the Protopasta Iridescent Ice PLA. I think this is the nicest looking one of the bunch because you're not seeing your motif as a surface imprint, but you're just seeing the effect of the refraction bending light differently. So it's a really strong and it's a really good contrast. Kind of like those computer game demos back when they first figured out how to make glass that looks decent. So plain filaments it is for me. Anything that has glitter or even fibers in it tends to hide the 3D printed look, so it will also hide the effect of Velocity Painting, so there's no point in using those. Cool, so what should you actually put on or over your prints? I mean, the obvious thing to do is tattooing vases, and that's all right. For these, you'd either use a floral pattern or some pattern that is repeating, so you don't get that seam in one spot. For this, you slice your vase as usual, vase mode on or off, and then use a cylindrical projection to wrap your image around. It can be hard to figure out what your image proportions are supposed to be. So to get something that doesn't look like this abomination, here's an easy way to figure it out. You start with an approximate diameter of your part. In this case, it's easy, I designed this part. Well done, Tom. But if you have a vase that actually has a shape to it, just make an educated guess. Multiply your diameter with 3 to get the circumference, roughly, and that's your image width that you can then use with an aspect ratio calculator to figure out how tall you need to set your image to get it roughly proportional. But then again, it can be fun to play with overstretched designs. Those can look pretty interesting too. The patterns that I used for these prints, I got from FreePic. They're just free stock images basically, but there are tons of other designs out there that you can just use. Just a quick Google of free pattern or free floral graphics or whatever you're into will bring up a ton of options. Basics done. Let's show you 5 more tricks to get the most out of your Velocity Painted parts. Number 1, contrast. Okay, Velocity Painting works on edges basically. So if your design has poor contrast to start, give it a bit more contrast in Photoshop or GIMP. You can also play with edge detect filters for a different look. Because Velocity Painting works per layer, if you have a design like this that has continuous vertical bits in the top and bottom of these hexagons, anything but the start and end of that bit aren't going to show up well. What you can do though is to simply rotate the design ever so slightly by 5, 10 or 15 degrees so that you do get that contrast in each layer. Number 2, previews. If you want to get a rough idea of how your part is going to look, just preview it. Slick3R Slicer doesn't support loading G-code back into the preview, but Cura does. So open up your G-code in Cura, change the mode to feed rates, and there you go. Super easy preview if you don't want to print the design to see what Velocity Painting is going to do to it. We don't preview it. I mean, surprises are fun too. Number 3. Imprint designs without edges. If you look at these prints, they have that frame-like border around where the design ends and the rest of the print starts. To get rid of these edges, you have a few different options. And because I figured out better ways to do this than what I had originally written in the script, here are those options as voiceover. They all center around blending the speed of your edges with the non-velocity painted region. White is fast, black is slow, and the velocity painting tool uses the slowest speed for anything that isn't covered by your image. So if you have the option to fill the background of your image with a full black, it will just blend perfectly. You can also add a black border on the left and right edges of your input image and feather it in. This doesn't completely erase the transition, but at least smooths it out a ton. Or, very simply, make sure your image covers your entire part and extend it if necessary if using the X, Y, or Z projections. Number 4. Use velocity painting for non-artistic purposes. So, at its core, velocity painting just maps different print speeds onto different areas of your prints, which means that you can use it to just straight up set speeds for specific areas. So if, for example, you need the top of your part printed at a different speed than the bottom because it's a very slim part that might wobble or fall over, well, create a gradient and use that with projection X or Y. If you've got several parts that need to be printed at different speeds and can't set that in your slicer, just put them in different corners of your print bed and fill those areas in the matching shades in an image file. And what you can also use velocity painting for is to tune in your printer. If you're using linear advance, which is meant to compensate for those exact artifacts velocity painting creates, you can tune your linear advance settings so that the velocity painted part looks as close to the original file as possible. Of course, it's basically impossible to get it perfect, and if you use linear advance already, you will have a hard time getting velocity painting to work as intended. Number 5, do your own thing. Velocity painting is a great tool, even used as is for the simple stuff like that. But like every tool, it's best used for the things that you uniquely want to do with it. It all comes down to being able to use some simple image editing software, either to improve the designs you already have or create completely new ones from scratch. So definitely look into at least learning the basics in Photoshop and Illustrator or the free alternatives GIMP and Inkscape. And you know what a great place to learn that software is? Today's sponsor, Skillshare. Wow, that was smooth. All right, here's how Skillshare fits in. So they've got a ton of online courses that you can take at your own pace, and they've got everything covered from business development over modeling with CAD, but they've also got Meg Lewis's Fundamentals of Photoshop series, which basically, even if you've never used any photo editing software before, it'll show you all the basics and get you right up to speed. Premium memberships for Skillshare start at around $10 a month, but we've also got 200 free trials to give away. If you're one of the first 200 people to sign up with the link in the video description below, you'll get your first 2 months of Skillshare Premium for free. These spots do go quickly, so don't miss it. Thank you, Skillshare. So, what are you going to use velocity painting for? It really works on any printer, and it's so quick and easy to use. It's almost a waste not to use it for parts you want to make a bit more unique. I'm definitely going to be using it for lampshades where light just right passes through them using the iridescent ice PLA from Protopasta, and just for little bits that I don't want to look as 3D printed as usual, where you'd use that particle sparkle filament otherwise. I'm definitely going to try if I can emulate that look just by adding texture with velocity painting, but definitely share what you're doing with it in the comments below. If you've got questions about the process, why not ask them in the forums at discuss.toms3d.org. And as always, if you feel like you've learned something, hit that like button, smash it if you so desire. And if you like what I'm doing here, get subscribed and support the channel on Patreon. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.